Eminent field biologist George Schaller once said, "There are never victories in conservation. If you want to save a species or a habitat, it's a fight forevermore. You can never turn your back." As a father and lover of nature and wild things, this quote has inspired me to ponder my children's future and whether they too will be able to experience the magnificent creatures that call this earth home. My name is Ross Thomas. I'm an adventurer, outdoorsman, and proud resident of the beautiful Central California coast. The condor has long been synonymous with this rugged coastline, but its survival as a species hangs in the balance. I'm on a quest to find out why this once widespread scavenger, North America's largest land bird, is disappearing before our very eyes. In an effort to find truth and transparency, I've reached out to the Ventana Wildlife Society, scientists and experts leading the recovery effort in California, bringing these birds back from the edge of extinction. Join me as we embark on an adventure of discovery into the mysterious life and death of the California condor.
How was your night?
A little foggy, a little cold under the stars, but beautiful.
All right, let's do it. I thought we'd start the adventure right here at the nest. You know, nesting is kind of like the pinnacle of all of our work. It's the ultimate reward, is to see these birds nesting on their own out in the wild. And
yeah, you know, where I was camping last night, I was thinking like, oh, maybe I'll get lucky and condor will fly over. Didn't see one, but it also got me thinking like, you got the ocean right here and some pretty steep terrain.
Yeah, were you in the fog last night or were you above it?
I got a little mixed bag of the elements. I got some fog. I was definitely kind of soaked when I got up.
Yeah, fog's really important. You know, the condors definitely are cued into it, and they tend to nest down below in the fog layer, you know, where the redwoods are. And again, that dynamic, they come right out of the fog and they're in the sun, and that's where later today we're gonna end up in both worlds, the fog, and then we'll be up in the sunny, hot, you know, exposed ridge tops.
Yeah, man, we've been talking about this for a while, so I'm glad it,
oh, yeah,
it
I'm
finally
excited.
Worked out.
I know, I'm excited to get you up here.
And just one of their feathers.
Yeah, that's a primary Whoa. Feather, pretty cool. So that's one of the ones out on the end of their wing when they're flying.
Huge.
Yeah, bend it, feel how flexible it is. It's pretty, they're nature builds them the best.
Wow. It's amazing.
Yeah, super light. Super light, super strong.
That makes sense because, I mean, here we are up in the fog line going to the nest trail.
Yep.
But then they could be, what, like 50 miles away?
Yeah, they're probably out looking for food right now. The parents come back with a bunch of meat and they'll give it a couple pounds of food, regurgitate it, which is a really, not the most pleasant thing to watch, but
hey,
it's efficient, you know?
Nature has its ways,
yes.
Man.
Here we are. Where the adventure begins. So yeah, grab your backpack and I'll get the scope.
I can see why the condors would want to nest here. This is epic.
You ready to hit it?
Let's do it.
Hey, yeah, we probably want to keep our voices down. We're getting closer to the nest. The tree's right over here, yeah. We're gonna hike in around and try to get a view of it. So see, there's a topped redwood, broken,
yeah.
Right in the middle of the grove. And the chick is just to the right. It's really hard to see.
I'm gonna have to get my binos out.
Yeah. Here, and I'll get the scope on it.
Okay. Oh, yes.
See it?
Yep. Wow.
Talk about some amazing nature's camouflage. I mean, you really have to know right where to pinpoint that bird to know that there's a bird there.
Yes.
And are you saying that that's the chick?
Yeah.
That's the chick?
I've never seen a condor chick, so I'm thinking of like a little chick, you know? I'm like going like, is that one of the parents? But that's the young condor.
Yeah, this chick is almost the same size as mom and dad, but it doesn't have the feathers yet, so it doesn't look like an adult. Oh, and it will have that dark plumage, that darker fuzzy head for the first 2-3 years of its life, and then they transition, and at about 5 or 6 years old, it'd have the pink red head that, you know, people will always associate with condors. The great thing is these birds are acting as wild as their ancestors. You know, they're going right back into those niches, those ancient niches they had. They're feeding on the coast like they did probably 1,000 years ago, nesting in these redwoods like they did 1,000 years ago.
Wow.
That whole connection is back and intact. And this is one of the best examples of that. Ross, check it out.
Oh.
Here they come. Here comes one of the pair.
No way.
Look how graceful they come in.
What are the odds?
I know. Oh, look how excited the chick's getting.
Whoa, what is the chick doing?
It's hard to describe, but it's rolling its wings. Let the feeding begin.
So wait, this isn't coming from the little paunch area?
Yeah, it is. They're pushing it up from their crop into the chick's mouth. And that's why this is definitely a rare sight. And you'll literally see that chick's crop grow. this chick is very well fed.
I mean, that's pretty tough to beat right there, Joe. I mean, that was a once in a lifetime opportunity, man. Thank you so much.
No problem. We got quite an adventure in front of us, so I think we should hit the road.
All right, man, I'm excited.
All right. So this morning was pretty amazing. We got to see the young condor coming out of the nest and in the redwoods down here in Big Sur, right on the coast. But now we're coming up to where it all started. You know, this whole project started at the sanctuary. You know, you think about where we just came from, and now here we are, not even 10, 15 minutes off Highway 1, and we're almost at 2,000 feet. It's one of the amazing parts of this drive is we kind of navigate through all of the Big Sur habitats.
We just came from that fog bank down there.
Yeah.
It felt like we were in a whole other world. Now that's actually supposed to be the ocean, but it's an ocean of clouds.
A blanket of fog, yeah.
Blanket of fog.
You know, if you look at it overall, the nest and the sanctuary in a condor's mind are in the same place. You know, the challenge of this journey going from the nest all the way up here to the sanctuary, you know, it's taking us most of the day, whereas for that pair of condors, 5-minute flight. You know, they need big areas. They need these big protected areas. The fire did heavy damage to our road and our sanctuary, so we're gonna have to do a little hiking. All right, this is the end of the drive part. Now it's time to hike.
Hike it in the rest of the way, huh?
All right, just need our packs. Yeah, good. Let's do it. Yeah, the trail's right over here. Watch your step going down.
You could see them anywhere out here on the journey.
Oh yeah, they can cover so much terrain so fast. They could be on this snag right here. They could be on that mountain peak over there. And again, it would take them 5 minutes to get from point A to point B. Might take you and I a week to hike that far, you know, so.
So when you guys are using your telemetry and you're trying to track them with your tracking systems, I mean, is there a certain range they can go until you lose them, or are you always able to ping them?
Yeah, line of sight, we can get them about 20 miles. So if they're out over those mountain peaks, we would pick up their signal.
Uh-huh.
And it's a really important tool, you know, the radio telemetry, we're able to find them. And especially if one gets sick or we think it's dying, we can get to it. Ideally, we get to it before it dies, but even if it dies and we get to it too late, we can at least recover it and find out what it died, what killed it.
Got a ways to go, should we carry on?
Yeah, we should get moving.
All right, lead the way. Oh man.
Quite the hike.
Look at this view though. Wow, that is just stunning. But at the same time,
you can really see the devastation from the wildfires, huh?
Yeah, this area got scorched, and you know, we're pretty close to the sanctuary. Oh, there's a condor right there. Yeah, so you can tell, see the white underwing triangle patches underneath the wing? And you can just see the wingspan. Look how massive that is.
Is that a pretty good sign that they're going to be there?
Yeah, we should head that direction. They're heading right to where we want to go.
Okay, let's go.
Let's hit it. Okay, Ross, this looks like our spot right here.
Oh, yeah.
It's nice and hidden.
Got a good vantage point, too.
Yeah, we have a really good vantage point right here. You can spot them right down over the hill here.
Oh, yeah, there's a few of them.
Yeah, we got at least five down there feeding right now.
Wow. They're pretty big up close in the binos.
Yeah, and you can really see how efficient they are at eating. I mean, they are just rendering these carcasses pretty quickly. Those sharp beaks allow them to get to that cowhide, you know, really thick, and they can just rip right through it.
So it looks like they're kind of jockeying for position right now.
So you'll notice the dominant bird, 209 there, he's kind of ruling the carcass, and that's pretty typical. And once he gets full enough, the other birds will start moving in.
So how do I know what I'm looking at with the numbers? What's the significance of the numbers?
Yeah, so the numbers help us identify them with binoculars from a distance. We can identify the individuals.
Uh-huh.
So they each are assigned, when they're born, a stud book number.
So today I'm seeing 200s. I'm not seeing any hundreds at the
moment. Yeah, so 209 is the oldest bird down there. And he's now 23 years old.
So have the condors come to expect this sanctuary as a dependable food source?
Yeah, definitely. You know, and the food's, you know, not only important to, you know, as a lead-free food source, but we're always releasing birds. So young birds that are learning how to feed on their own, this is a good fallback for them. It's a kind of a training ground. We look at these sites as where they cut their teeth, where these birds learn how to fly, where they, you know, the birds that come from captivity as chicks and we release have a little tougher job than birds coming wild out of the nest that have mom and dad showing them around. But you know, that natural time, like the nestling we saw this morning, will leave the nest at 6 months, spend the next year with mom and dad getting shown the ropes after it leaves the nest and learns how to fly.
Wow.
So the mom and dad will skip next year breeding. So condors breed really slow, one egg every other year, you know, one chick every other year. So it's a huge investment in their young. And that's why mortality rates, you know, these higher mortality rates we're seeing from lead poisoning, you know, for a long-lived, slow-breeding species, condors can't keep up.
Yeah.
These carcasses are a really key aspect, but on the other side of this, as a biologist, I can't wait for the day that we don't have to put these out because the lead threat is gone.
Oh, look at that one taking off right there.
Oh,
wow.
Perfect. Look at that. Massive wingspan.
Is he
you know, he's going to head over to this tree over there. We should get over. You want to head over that way?
Yeah, he's roosting in a tree. Let's do it.
Yeah, let's go check him out. Look, it's 171. She's one of our oldest.
Oh, wow, man, she's beautiful. She just seems pretty docile right now, hanging out on that branch, huh?
Yeah, it's hard to believe she's 24 years old now, and she definitely carries a wisdom with her, and you can almost see it in her face. She's very confident, and she's definitely very territorial of this area. You know, she's definitely one of the guardians of the sanctuary, I would say.
So I can imagine that the journey from a condor hatching to this point in time, I mean, what a victory.
Yeah, all these birds have these trials and tribulations they go through as they grow, you know. So again, to see them cut short by lead poisoning is always a heartbreaker. So we're rooting for 171. And
at the end of the day, you're a wildlife biologist. You spent a good portion of your life dedicated to these birds. And then when you know a single bird like that so intimately, there must be some part of you that feels connected to that, but looks forward to seeing that bird out there.
Oh, yeah, just like today when we spotted her just now, you know, it's because it is a scary time with lead poisoning. You don't know if it's the last time you're going to see a bird, you know, a bird you've known for 24 years.
So these birds come to this sanctuary. It's a beautiful place. There's food here, there's habitat here, but they also have a huge range, right? So they travel.
Yeah, this is one pit stop.
Right, so they're also in the back country, way back in the Santa Lucia Range, the Ventana Wild.
Pinnacles National Park.
Pinnacles, essentially, they're eating wild carcasses as well. This isn't their sole food.
I think
food.
That's why she's here today. You know, she just fed, you can see that she's got a huge crop right now. She's got a, her crop is just booming.
And the crop is just, is that right there underneath the
gym? Yeah, right underneath her neck. Probably 2 to 3 pounds of meat in there.
Oh my gosh, yeah, look at that.
Yeah, as a crew, we identify the size of a crop by using ball size terms. You're either a tennis ball, a softball, or a volleyball in size. She's pushing almost a volleyball right now. And again, a lot of the food they're finding is not the stuff we're putting out. I mean, these birds are finding more than enough food on their own. The problem is that wild food can be tainted with lead.
Yeah, the interesting thing to me, Joe, is that they clearly like to hang out in that tree, but it's also beautifully ironic because the tree is so dead and burnt out. And then looking around the sanctuary, you got little pockets of green, but that whole area over there seems to have been decimated in the fire.
Yeah, that area over there is where our bunkhouse was, where we stay when we're up here, and where we lost our cabin.
So that's all burned to the ground now?
That's all burned to the ground, and yeah, I wanted to show you that as well if you want to hike over.
Yeah, I'm gonna grab my hat.
All right, here we are. Finally made it to the base camp.
Wow, look at that. We just came from all the way on the other side of that canyon over there, huh?
Yep, this is our old storage shed. This is where we kept all of our equipment.
Oh man.
Yeah, you can
see. That metal is just mangled.
Yeah, you can see it actually melted the metal, like bent the metal.
So just off to the left too, I'm seeing this whole mountainside again, just
yeah,
kind of.
This is where the direction the fire came, which our cam captured. It came from this direction over here. And we're pretty sure this burnt first.
Uh-huh.
And then it moved towards and got our cabin next.
So the bunkhouse is just
over
here?
Yeah, it's just right down here. Pretty much toasted the entire structure. And
wow, look at that.
Yeah, so this is the what's left of our bunkhouse. This was our home away from home. So
plans to rebuild?
Yes.
So why rebuild? Why rebuild here when you know fire rips through this area? I mean, Dolan Fire came right over the top of that crest.
It's part of the natural landscape. It's part of the process up here, and you just have to be prepared for it. Fortunately, we can rebuild. The hardest part for us was losing the birds. You know, you can't replace those birds and that tribal knowledge each of those individual birds had of the 9 that burned that night up here. But you know, looking at the glass half empty versus half full, we could have lost 28 birds that night. The number of birds that have died from fire, you know, I think the fire conjured up more drama, but at the end of the day, the real issue for these birds is something that's not as dramatic. It's actually really pitiful to watch these birds suffer as these deaths from lead poisoning. I mean, lead poisoning deaths have, you know, compared to fire deaths, it's, you can't even compare.
So Joe, we've seen glimmers of hope today, you know, seeing that chick in the redwood nest this morning, which was just phenomenal. Seeing condors in flight, feeding, hanging out in the roost today. So much positive in this story, but their future still hangs in the balance. They are not out of the woods yet. How can we get to the bottom of what is really killing these birds?
Unfortunately, you know, that would require a little deeper dive into what's happening and the threat to these birds. So my question to you is, are you ready for the next part of this adventure?
Absolutely, let's do it.
My experience with Joe and the condors was beautiful and profound. It left me with an even deeper desire to protect this incredible species. But with that desire comes the understanding that to be a part of the change, I have to explore some of the devastating effects we humans have on the natural world.